My name is Almas. I am based in Brazil. Originally, I'm from Pakistan, and I'm a postdoc researcher in Unicamp, Brazil.
What are your main research topics?
Well, I'm working with recycling technologies. In my PhD, I worked with recycling citrus industrial waste, and we extracted some value-added products from that. After that, I entered in a research area that was linked with recycling technologies that were used, you know, for the water reclamation. We were studying how we can purify the wastewater in the wastewater treatment plants. And currently, I'm working with the mass spectrometric techniques, and we are using that techniques for analysis of different kinds of substances.
Why are you so passionate about recycling?
Well, I am passionate about recycling because I think that a world needs this. We have lots and lots of problems, you know, with the linked with the waste generation. And when the companies and the industries, they generate waste, they don't know what to do with that. And normally, let's say, if I talk about citrus industrial waste, every year, as Brazil is the largest orange producer, so millions of tons of oranges, they are treated in the citrus industry. And as a result, millions of tons of waste is generated, you know, because, I mean, when you treat orange, around 50% of that is left as a waste, and that is normally dumped at some far place. So what we did, me with my PhD advisor and some other students as well, we tried to use that so-called waste, and tried to convert that into something really, you know, usable and something really economically viable. And also, if I talk about the water recycling technologies, I think that the next problem that the world is going to face is a water shortage problem, and we really need to think about it. I mean, how we can reduce water consumption, and what kind of technologies we can utilize to reuse the water. I mean, let's say for the toilet flushing, or, you know, for the washing purposes, or the house cleaning. I mean, I think we can use reclaimed water for that purpose instead of using the drinking water for that purpose.
What kind of results did you get from your dissertation?
Okay, well, from the orange waste, the four main products that we extracted were, first of all, I would like to say pectin. Pectin is used, you know, it's a kind of a gelling agent, and it can be used, you know, in the jams, jellies, marmalades, or in the juice industry, you know, for thickening purpose. And then the second one that we obtained, it was hispiridine, that is an antioxidant, you know, it's an antidepressant as well. It's a kind of a natural product, and it can be used as a remedy. Next product that we obtained, that was the nanocellulose. And nanocellulose, you know, it's nowadays it's kind of a very, you know, active research area, and they can be used, you know, they can be used for the as the protective sheets, you know, on the cell phones or on the cars, and there are many other uses as well that are under research study. And then it was bioethanol. I mean, bioethanol is something that you can use for running the cars. So, I mean, Brazil is a country that has made an example for the whole world, because it's the world's largest producer of, bioethanol. But that bioethanol is actually the first generation bioethanol. But in our case, we are working on from the bio waste. That is the second generation biofuel. And that is the technology that... that is the next technology, that is a future technology, because taking out bioethanol from the food products is something that has many challenges. Probably the food crops, they could be used, you know, for providing food, because the world is, you know, has a lot of problem even with the food scarcity, food shortage. So probably we can use that for the other purpose, the food items. But the waste that is left, you know, the agricultural waste that is left, that waste can be converted, you know, in a biofuel. So here in Brazil, there are many laboratories, you know, they are doing research. Actually, there are many ways, you know, to convert that into biofuel. But the only problem is that the economical viability of that process, you know, on the industrial level. But in our case, when we tried, you know, when we were exploring this process, so we had this this objective in our mind that we need to reduce the waste. We need to reduce the waste, but also we need to make a process that should be economically viable. I mean, that could be applied on the industrial scale. So when you work on the industrial scale, you need to think about the money. The input and the output, they should be, you know, in a balance. Or it should generate some revenue as well. So in our case, we tried, you know, different enzymes, because right now the main problem that the industry is facing, they are the high cost of enzymes. So we used shuck enzymes that are the lower in they are the lowest known in the cost. So we think that the process is economically viable.
The approach that you used was a new one?
Yes, it was a new approach in the sense that in Brazil, our group was the first one who tried to work with this and was being successful. And our approach was to extract as maximum products, you know, as we can.
And what are the possible real-world applications of your results?
I think this product is marvelous, and all the products that we extracted, we can extract them on the industrial scale. Right now, we are working with some companies, you know, to make some contract with us, you know, with our lab, and we are trying to share the patent with them.
And what does it mean to you to be a scientist?
For me, to be a scientist is, you know, I feel that it's a really big responsibility. It's really, really a big responsibility, because every new disease that the world is facing, the population is facing, or any environmental problem, you know, or any real life problem that the world is facing, I think that scientists, they try their best and you know, to solve that problem, you know, at the research level, at the very basic level. Well, there are two kinds of researches. One is the basic research, the other one is the applied research. And I think that both of them, they're really, really important, because the basic research, I mean, it gives the fundamentals, you know, of our future concepts related to science, while the applied research, it is something that deals with the current problems that the population is facing. So I feel that both of them, they're equally important, and I'm really passionate about them.
Why did you become a researcher?
Well, I became a researcher because I think that I'm quite ambitious, and I want to solve certain problems faced by the society. If I talk about my childhood, I mean, I never thought about this, that I would be a researcher. I would be, a future scientist. I belong to a village from Pakistan, where I think I'm the first one who came out of, you know, that village, you know, and my parents, they sent abroad for having a scientific career. Because when I was a child, I never thought that I would be a scientist. I never thought, because I was like, okay, I can be a doctor, or I can be an engineer, or, you know, any other thing, but, you know, scientist, I mean, how can a woman be a scientist? Or I never have seen scientists around me. So that was something, you know, I never even thought about it. But yes, when I started my master's, I always tried to, I tried to think about, you know, science and how it works. I was in Pakistan, and at that time, it was, there were lack of resources. But then I got to know about the fellowship that is offered by the World Academy of Science, TWAS. I applied for that, and eventually I started my research career in Brazil.
What kind of challenges did you encounter on your way?
Well, I think that there were many challenges. Like, I was coming from Pakistan, a society from where, we don't have that much female scientists. And then, my family, they were really supportive. My father, my mother, my siblings. But of course, society, they impose, you know, a lot of things on you, and then they're like, I mean, even there it's not common for the girls, you know, to travel alone abroad. And then working on science, you know, away from the family, something, you know, it's a bit still, you know, not seen that much, you know, good vision. But the thing is that, okay, in the beginning it was a little bit difficult, but with the best of time, when I started showing that yes, I'm a girl, but I can do anything, and I can do work as a scientist, just like men from my country, they can do it, and I can be extraordinary as well, and I can be independent as well. So it is something that now makes me feel really proud of, and not just me, even my family. And I think that I can be probably I'm an example, you know, for some Pakistani girls who want to proceed, you know, their dreams, who want to do whatever they want.
What kind of advice would you give to another young woman who would like to become a researcher?
I would like to say that the doors are open for you. I mean, the doors are open for you. You just need to have courage, you know, to enter that door. Because all over the world, what I see that academies and the scientific councils, they are really encouraging women. I mean, wherever you would like to apply for higher studies, for research grants, they really encourage women. We need more and more women. So that the gender gap that exists in between science and women, it should be, you know, overcome. And secondly, there are many issues that are linked, you know, in the underdeveloped countries. I think that women from the underdeveloped countries, I will really, really encourage them not to have fear about anything. Just be bold, take the practical steps, look forward and work hard. You can do it.
And what motivates you?
Well, this is really a personal question. I think my motivation is my parents, because I see them, they have struggled throughout their lives to make their children independent. So what I feel that whenever I have some difficult times in my life, I just think about them. They are my motivation. And I just try to make myself better. I just try to make and have more and more achievements so that they can feel more and more proud of me.
Where do you see yourself in 5 or 10 years? What would you like to change?
Well, in the longer term, I would like to be a part of the policy making bodies at the regional or the government or the global, the local level. What I would like to change is that I would like to make a bridge, you know, and I would like to reduce the gap that exists between the scientific community and the policymakers.
What kind of society do you dream of?
Well, I dream of a society that is peaceful, because currently I feel that the only thing that the world needs currently right now, and the first priority, is peace. And then on the second level, I feel that there should be, I dream of a society where every individual knows about its responsibility, not just on a local level, but as a global, on the global level, as a global citizen.
Do you have a dream or a wish for the future?
Yes, my dream for the future is that our government officials and the policy makers, they start thinking on the global level, or I should say globally. Means they should consider their local interests as well, but the global interests as well. Because at the end of the day, we all human beings are the one who share this planet. So probably our one wrong policy can not only influence our local community, but also the global one. So I think I really wish that our politicians around the world, they start thinking about the planet Earth, about all of us, and they think about the global citizens, not just their local citizens.
Thank you, Alma, so much for this conversation.
Thanks to you for inviting me, for sharing my thoughts